good morning, everyone. Thank you all for coming to listen to me talk. Just bear with me. It was my brother's 21st birthday party last Friday night, so I'm still dealing with the repercussions of the decisions that I made. So we'll get through it together. So as Khan said, I'm the general manager at Ruby and I design our Liam label. And before I get started, I thought I'd give you a bit of context about what I do. So first of all, Ruby. So Ruby is designed by Diana Didovich. Basically, I think of Ruby as spirited youth, mischievous, cheeky, and charming. And Dee takes that playful approach into her design, and we're also playful in the way that we communicate. And then there's Liam. So Liam is designed by me. And Liam has that same playful approach, but is a little more simple and assured. So both Ruby and Liam, we do mainline collections, so spring, summer, autumn, winter. And then Ruby does pre-fall and resort injection collections. And then we also do accessories. So footwear, bags, costume jewelry, fine jewelry, and stationery. We have 9 brick and mortar stores around New Zealand and then 1 online store. And we make about 60-65% of our product here in Auckland, and then the rest is made in China. Okay, so I thought I would show you our company structure, because I'm always really fascinated to see how other people structure their companies. So at the top we have a board. Our board meets monthly, and I have to say, this discipline is so important. It's such an important thing for me and also our team. And it's a discipline that can be replicated across companies of many different sizes, including companies of one person. It's just a chance to take yourself out of the daily grind of what you're doing, think about the business from a slightly, at more of an arm's length, and strategize. So underneath the board is our managing director, who is also my mum. I report to my mum. that's a whole other conversation, and it took a lot of learning to get to a place where we had a really strong working relationship. And then underneath that is me, the general manager. So general manager, I generally manage things. That's literally what I do. Since I started at Ruby, I had always I'd always kind of encompassed both the creative and business sides of the company. And so it, in the end, was a natural progression for me to have general oversight over each of the different departments. But really what it is that row of people at the top there, it's their job to run their department, and it's my job to work with them to help them do the best job that they can do. The main thing with these heads of department is, and I'm sure that we are all aware of it, but I'm just going to reiterate it, it's employing good people. And so it's not necessarily that it's the person with the most experience, it's the person with the strongest desire to succeed in that specific role, and with the ability and tools within them inside themselves to do that. So I walk around the office literally like a meter reader. This is my clipboard, and that's how I arrange my time. So each of the different departments, I kind of break into my A4 piece of card. I rewrite this once a week because that's just how I work. I highlight things as they get done. And then underneath that piece of paper is just all of the bits and pieces that I'm working on that I need to have at my hands at any given time. So we actually had a board meeting yesterday, so and this is just my clipboard from this week. So a lot of what I've been working on is data analysis, looking at figures, etc. But there's also some sketches and stuff which I think have been cut off the page. Okay, so weird. My husband actually tells me off because I often use the word weird to describe something when I really should just think a little bit harder and use the word that I actually want to use. So in this case, I'm going to talk about weird being as a euphemism for bad. That's me. So I started at Ruby in 2008 when I was 24 years old. At the time, I had been through design school. I'd created a couple of sample collections and had spent a year working as a workroom and production assistant, and then another year basically whiling out, traveling around the States and Europe. So a pretty standard level of experience for someone at that age. And definitely at the time, I thought more than enough experience to take on what I did. When I started, my parents' company was in the process of taking over Ruby from the two women that had started it. And Diana, my design partner, the Ruby designer, came on a couple of months after me to design Ruby, and I was designing the Madam Hawk label. When I started, only one head office team member from old Ruby came on board to new Ruby. So we had to build the team right from the ground up. There was very little infrastructure, definitely in terms of a head office perspective, but there were four stores. And I remember at the time, the most frightening thing for me was that every single day those stores needed to open. And every single day they needed to have clothes in them for people to buy. So I had to, basically actually the saying, the show must go on, is absolutely etched in my mind from that time. And it's just one of those things where you're presented with a design problem, which was get stock in store. And I just had to find the quickest, most simple solution to get it in there. So I had to put aside a lot of my design school values about conceptually what a garment meant. And really it was just more about of the options that we could muster up, which was the best option to put into store. So basically a lot of the time when a business is being taken over, the old owners want to clear out of a lot of their stock. Basically, they don't want to commit to a stock that they may or may not want, depending on how the sale and purchase goes. And then the new owners, because clothing takes time to make, haven't actually had a chance to put new stock through production yet. So really, it was trying to find clothes to get into store, which was not ideal. Eventually, over time, we created better planning systems. Dee and I set up a workroom so that we could make our own patterns, and then we were able to actually design our own pieces and then eventually collections. So what was not clear to me now, what I didn't realize at the time, but is absolutely crystal clear to me now, is that I was being held back by a few things, which I'm going to go through now. And basically, this is the crux of my talk. So, I lacked confidence in my design skills, and I needed the recognition that awards and good grades gave me. So, I had become addicted, basically, to that feeling of inflation when you get a great grade or you win an award. And what I thought that I wanted when I left university was to measure my success by how well my clothing sold. But what I didn't realize was that what I was actually grasping for or craving or needing was the same recognition that an award gave me, that an award gave me from good sales. So basically, it definitely, as a designer, it's important to know what sells. But if you use that as a method to buoy your sense of creative worth, it's extremely dangerous. I was working for my family company, and I was anxious to prove myself. I felt like everyone was looking at me and thinking that I didn't deserve to have the job that I had. So already in an extremely high pressure situation, I loaded myself with extra pressure by trying to prove that I did actually deserve the role. As well as that, I had been a high achiever, so I came with that added baggage of, if it's not perfect, it's a failure. I had an unanchored design aesthetic. So basically, I was still young. And so I thought everything was amazing. And so I had developed a lot of conceptual design values at design school, but I hadn't really settled on a visual one. And so because of that, I was really easily swayed. And it meant that I started taking on board in a way which was not very useful, other people's opinions. Which led to me being incapable of properly trusting myself and my own ability and making my own judgment calls. So not being able to make my own judgment calls meant that I also had a limited ability to see my work from an outsider's perspective, which is, as a designer, ridiculous. You can't design if you can't imagine or perceive how somebody else is going to see your work. It looks like quite a bad time. It wasn't a bad time. I did learn how to manage these aspects, but it wasn't until 2012 that they really came up to the forefront, and I had to basically face them and then figure out how to neutralize them. So in 2011, we launched Liam. So I launched it at New Zealand Fashion Week in a joint show with Ruby, and it was a really successful show and a really exciting time. Because we are a retail brand rather than a wholesale brand, we decided in 2012 that we weren't going to show at New Zealand Fashion Week. But then an opportunity presented itself that we thought we would be stupid to refuse. So we essentially, we were in a situation where it was like, you guys should do the opening show, here is this great opportunity, and we were like, this offer will never be offered to us again. And so just as an aside, it's never a stupid idea to refuse an offer if you're not 100% sure that you're gonna nail it. I didn't know that at the time, and so we decided that yes, we would do this opening show at New Zealand Fashion Week. And so we had about 6 to 8 weeks to pull both the Ruby and the Liam collections together, and at that point we still had quite a small team. Dee and I were making still a lot of our own patterns. And that entire time, I really genuinely felt like it was a slow motion train wreck. I knew that the collection was not looking good, but my confidence was at an all time low, and I didn't have the ability to use the tools within inside myself to sort it out. So I was kind of seeking approval and seeking everyone else's opinion about what I should be doing with the collection, which in the end was a waste of time, but also the result was not a particularly great collection. So to cut a long and very painful story short, we went ahead with the show. This is a photo of backstage the morning of the show. That's me blurred in the background. And I think it captures my spirit that morning quite well. Backstage that morning was actually extremely terrible for me. That side of the fashion industry is so much about doing a PR job on yourself. And so I had to hold my head high and pretend that I was proud of something that I was actually really embarrassed of, which kind of contradicts everything that I'm about, because I'm basically more about brutal honesty, but I couldn't be that morning. As well as the PR job side of things, also when you do a fashion show, there are so many people that are there working for you. So models, photographers, sound and lighting techs, hair and makeup artists, etc. So essentially you are their manager for that day, and so you have to lead positively. So I had to basically. Walking out after, you know, like the classic, the models finish, everyone claps, and then the designer walks out, everyone claps more. I genuinely felt like somebody had peeled off my skin and I was walking into a vat of acid. I know it sounds dramatic, but it did really feel like that. It was awful. It was awful. Basically, somebody reviewed the collection and called it underwhelming, and it was upsetting because it was underwhelming. They were absolutely 100% correct. And so I got home that night, I was a bit drunk, and I basically, I did this really emo Facebook post, which I was really embarrassed of, and I was embarrassed about everything, and I deleted it the next day because, yeah. But that Facebook post actually led to a girl that I'd been to university with that I hadn't seen for 5 years getting in touch with me, and I'm actually going to read her Facebook message because I can. Shimmy girl, I read this last night and thought of you. And this is a quote. If I had to give you one piece of advice, it would be this. Don't be intimidated by other people's opinions. Only mediocrity is sure of itself. So take risks and do what you really want to do. Seek out people who aren't afraid of making mistakes and who, therefore, do make mistakes. Because of that, their work often isn't recognized, but they're precisely the kind of people who change the world and, after many mistakes, do something that will transform their community completely. End quote. So, and then this is still her talking. The main gist of it for me was keep doing what you want to do, and if you believe in it 100%, comments like underwhelming won't even touch on your goodness, exclamation mark. You're a hardworking babe, keep mixing it up, kiss, kiss. To which I kind of did this like incoherent thank you, and she replied saying, no worries, hun. Everyone that tries for something will go through the same thing at some stage. We went to a talk with Henry Holland, and he said the same thing. His third or fourth collection in was a disaster, but because of that disaster, it pushed him to be so much better, because you never want to be in that place again, exclamation mark. Take care, little miss. Kiss, kiss. So, two things. Since preparing this presentation, I now know that that quote came from Paulo Coelho, who wrote The Alchemist, which is a bit of a lol and potentially deeply uncool. but that's fine. And then the second thing is, it's actually really amazing, the people who reach out to you when you really need it. I hadn't seen her for a long time. I haven't seen her since. But in the process of making this, I actually got in touch with her to let her know how much that Facebook message meant to me and how much it actually was a catalyst for me to shift my way of thinking. It's hard to make different choices when you're in a really difficult situation, but actually that's the most important time to make them. So you have to learn how to compartmentalize that fear and those bad feelings and put them to one side so that you can find a way forward through the problem. So it's great to quote from the Alchemist guy and all, but here are some practical ways that I worked through this issue. I'm just gonna cough, so just... There we go. Okay, so first of all, I needed to gain better perspective on my work. So what I do now is I get my work to a semi-finished state, photograph it on a person on a white wall, standing against a white wall, as opposed to me self-timer like running into the frame, print the work out, pin it to my wall, and have some distance from it. It helps that a lot of my time is actually not spent designing, so that I have no choice but to have distance, as in time, from my work. I started spending a lot of time in store, so watching the way that customers actually interacted with my work has been invaluable, especially when they don't know that I'm the designer. So more people in Auckland know who I am, so it's much more useful to be out in our southern stores, basically, because they a lot of the time don't know who I am. The other thing that I do is during the sampling process, I give my samples mostly to workmates to wear, so I can see them out of the corner of my eye walking around in my clothing, rather than it being like front and center in my mind. Also, obviously, as they feel more comfortable giving me constructive criticism, they can let me know what they like and don't like about the garment. Removing emotion. So creating for me comes from, I guess, like an emotional or a spiritual place. But When it comes to design, I have to remove my emotion from it. So in the same way that I can't be absolutely crushed by something that doesn't sell well, I can't also be inflated by something that does. I need to be objectively aware of what is selling, and I need to understand why it's selling so that I can replicate it, or why it's not selling so I can change it for next time. So I channel my creativity sometimes sneakily and probably in kind of inefficient, unnecessary ways into my clothes. But also it's not my only outlet for creativity, and that's been a really important thing. I work in a business. Our business makes clothes. Not all of my creative needs are going to be met by that business, and that's actually okay. Maturity was the only thing that got me past my anxiety around proving myself about working for my family company. And sometimes you just need to grow up and learn how to let go of the emotions that are not useful. I spend as little time as possible looking at other clothing designers' work. It's obviously important for me to know what's going on in the marketplace, but the easiest way for me to start blurring the edges of who I am as a clothing designer is to look at other clothing products. I can't really explain why, but I think we probably can all understand. But what it means is that I get all of my inspiration from every single other field other than clothing. And inspiration is everywhere. So you just need to basically like turn on that part of your brain. So just keep making more and more and more clothes. And instead of feeling diminished and upset by noticing something in my work which is not as successful as I'd like it to be, I need to try and turn that around so that I'm grateful for being able to recognize it. And then if it's not too late on one particular garment or one particular product, I can make a change. But if it is too late, if it's in store and there's nothing you can do about it, making sure that I keep, I remember that for next time. And having discipline. So I leave work at least once a week at 5:30, and I don't work more than 5 days a week unless it's absolutely necessary. Having that space from my work is so important, because it means that I can basically be a person rather than just like this weird, upset, angry, stressed out worker. That's it. Basically, that's the story of a bad time that I had as a designer. But you know, in seriousness, it's been good for me to prepare this presentation because it's really reinforced two things in my mind. So first of all, bad things happen, and so you need to be able to compartmentalize those bad feelings so that you can find a solution. There's always a solution. You can find a solution to the problem as quickly as possible and with minimal impact on your mental health, your workplace, and your personal life. The other thing, hang on a minute, there were two things. Now, let me see if I can remember the second one. No, I don't think I'm going to be able to remember it. I think while I'm standing up here in front of you all, looking at me, I think that the second one is, as a designer, you need to make products that other people interact with and other people use. And so you need to understand what it is that they want, but also you can't blur the edges between you and them and completely lose your identity. So it's finding a balance that you literally daily have to keep checking that you're not creating in a vacuum, but you're also not trying to be all things to all people. That was it. Yeah, cool.